What would you say the secrets of tax lien investing are? And what are some different things here that we cover? First off, some of these things, I guess we've got some things well, some of these things might be somewhat fundamental, but tax sales are more than just tax liens. That's one of the big things to understand in the beginning. I guess when we started, tax liens were it was kind of a generic term to describe everything, that was just never really, I mean, that was not what we found. It was never the case. We found that there were different things you'd run into kind of depending on what state you were dealing with, and what you really had were some distinct systems. And the reason for that was because property tax laws were based on state laws. So in other words, state laws are what are giving counties the power to withdraw or to take a property tax. And because of that, they're also identifying how property taxes are going to be enforced. So what that really means is that you've got 50 different, sets of laws that describe, how these things are to take place, and they're all different in their own ways. For the most part, though, you can take those 50 and break them down into three systems. You've got tax lien states, you've got tax deed states, and you've got redemption deed states. And I say, tax lien states and so on because typically, a state will use one system. The only exception to that are a couple of states like Florida. Florida is an exception to that. They are two. They're actually a tax lien state and a tax deed state. Now, I think if we were to look at this in even more simplistic terms, we could say, that based on what the outcome is, what you're after. Tax liens, we're talking about tax lien redemption. We're talking about making high interest rate returns on your money. Okay, it's about purchasing liens, which we'll talk about in a minute. Tax deeds, we're talking about properties that have been foreclosed on. These are tax foreclosures, essentially. So a tax foreclosure, well, you're talking about a property that's been lost due to delinquent property taxes and that is now, sold at auction. So if you buy a tax foreclosure, you're just buying the property outright. And redemption deeds are the third system that we have. Texas, Steve, what are some of the other states that are out there?
Texas, Georgia, Pennsylvania has kind of a redemption deed system, but then they eventually go to tax deeds. Connecticut, there's quite a few different states out there. There's about 10 or so, 8 to 10, that have some type of redemption deed system. And really, what that is just a it's like a tax deed, but it has a redemption period like a tax lien certificate. So the property owner has a short time frame. And what's different about redemption deeds versus tax liens as well is redemption deeds have a shorter redemption period. Usually they're 6 months to a year. Texas has a 6 month redemption period and then a 2 year redemption period on homestead properties and farmland only. They don't want to have a farmer lose his land in 6 months if he can't make his property taxes. That's not going to look good. And then also a personal homeowner, if it's that their personal property, they have 2 years. Otherwise, it's going to be 6 months to a year in most cases.
Yeah, absolutely. Now we've got a couple of slides here that explain tax liens, but then we basically just kind of dive right into the other secrets here. Now, if we're talking about redemption periods, if any of that sounds foreign, let's just cover a couple of things real quickly. When it comes to counties, local governments, they're the ones that actually do the work of, collecting the property tax. They're also the ones that are responsible for enforcing it. Now, property taxes are generally the primary source of revenue for most counties. And along with every tax, you have to have an enforcement system in place, or it's never going to get paid. No, people would never pay their taxes if they weren't forced to. So that's really where a tax lien comes in, which we're going to dig into here a little bit. What exactly is a tax lien? Well, we know that it's due to delinquent property taxes and what's owed in delinquent taxes, but really the question is, what's a lien? And a lien is a form of security interest that's granted over an item, over maybe a piece of property. And the idea is to secure the payment or the repayment of a debt, something that's owed. So basically what happens is, if there's a piece of property, what a lien is it allows you to take possession of that property and use that property as collateral for another debt. Okay. And they were able to do this on a state level. So what you're talking about is really something pretty powerful in the real estate world. Now, what the lien does specifically, though, is really what's impressive. It, first off, it prevents the transfer of ownership. So you can't sell the property while it's there, and it can be used to foreclose on the property once a redemption period's expired. And the redemption period, every lien, every state that has tax liens also has a redemption period that's included with those. And that represents the grace period that property owners have. It also represents the duration of the investment and how long you could potentially have to wait on a tax lien you were to purchase before you could try to initiate the foreclosure process. The idea with tax liens really is not so much to try to get property. The idea for the county is just simply to find a way to make people pay their taxes. And that's because if they have enough people that are delinquent in their taxes, the county has a budget. The county has people they're paying on a regular basis. And if they don't have the money to pay them, they have to borrow the money. They have to increase tax rates. They just have to have some enforcement system that works. So it's also important to note that the way the tax lien system is designed, the vast majority of tax liens redeem. That's just the way that it's designed to work. Most people pay their taxes at some point, even if they're late. They're not going to allow it to go to foreclosure, not in most cases anyway. And really, the purpose for creating the lien, as far as the county's concerned, is just to create something that they can sell. And by creating that lien, they can sell that to an investor, and they can do that because right there in state law, it gives them permission to create these liens, to hold a sale, and it even gives maximum interest rate returns that you can earn by purchasing these liens. And they wanted it to be attractive when they wrote the sale in most cases. So they're talking about high interest rates. Usually we're talking about the lowest we know of is 10%. And you can get as high as, 24% or even more in some cases with penalties included.
Oh, yeah.
So, they wanted it to be an attractive investment, and that was because they needed people to come and buy it. They needed people to be drawn to it. And so, that's why they decided they would post things in the newspaper and see if they could draw people. They'd post the tax sale properties there, or the liens anyway, and so that investors from the public could come and show up and buy them. And that's how they did it for a long time. But what's changed is the internet. They used to be limited by how many people they could fit, there at the place. And there are still a lot of sales. Majority are still live sales. But we're transitioning to a time where there's more and more online sales. And they're making it easier and easier to buy online. Okay. So I guess if that were to cover the first thing there, there's more to tax liens than just tax liens. We're talking about sort of three different systems. We're talking about a lot of different things. But the second secret here is that tax liens are not a risky investment. We can say that, I had put that little clause down there, because you can make mistakes and a person could lose money. We've witnessed that happen. We've seen people not people we were working with. We've seen people at auctions that we tried to talk out of properties, because we knew they were junk, pay way too much for properties. It's possible to make mistakes in anything you do, but tax liens are not by nature a risky investment. If you understand how they work, it's very easy to buy them in a safe manner, in a manner that in some cases, guaranteed or a set interest rate that you're either going to make, a high interest rate like 18%, or you're going to take the property.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's almost like anything in life. If you were to buy something that's junk, it's going to be worth junk. If you buy something of value, then it's worth value. And with tax lien certificates, all you need to do is just not buy junk. And it's pretty easy to figure out what junk is once you've set some parameters and know what you're looking for.
Yeah, that really is true. In fact, I think that One of the things that's nice that you'll find with this is we want to find the easiest way to teach, and that's usually trying to break things down and make them as simple as possible. And with tax sales, I think with tax liens especially, we've got a pretty simple system in place here. Now, we're talking about just how low risk they really are. When you buy a tax lien, there's really one of two possibilities or possible outcomes there. Except in weird, rare cases, but this is pretty much what's going to happen. It's either redemption or foreclosure. You know, either the tax lien is going to redeem, and when that happens, you're going to get a check in the mail. Now, of course, it depends on when the property owner pays off their taxes as to when this occurs. So they're either going to pay their property taxes off at some point during that redemption period, or that redemption period comes to an end and the tax lien's used to foreclose on the property. Those are really the two possible outcomes there. They don't really leave room for anything else to happen. That's what happens. When you buy the tax lien, if it's a set interest rate return, then that's just simply what you earn. And that's based on, you know, the state laws and the state statutes. And you're dealing with the county. I mean, they do things by the books. All right, number three, not all states are equal in opportunity. What exactly do we mean by that? Oh, first off, when we're talking about tax lien states here, we're talking about the blue states and yellow states. Well, Nevada, sort of, but certainly Florida. So what exactly are the best states, you could say? Well, one of the things you have to figure out when you're looking to buy tax liens, one of the first things you have to understand is this. When you buy tax liens, you're investing to earn an interest rate return. That's how they work. If you're more interested in property, we'll talk a little bit more about tax deeds. But if you're interested in earning a high interest rate return on the investment, like I said, it's going to be a long-term investment, but really that you have to plan on long-term. The reality of it is they could pay their taxes off a few months after. They could wait till the very end of the redemption period, and we've had it happen at all different points in the redemption period, it's, I guess that part of it is unpredictable. You never really know, other than to say that the majority of, the vast majority of tax liens redeem. But some of the states here specifically, that we have listed here for tax liens, well, Florida, obviously, they actually are the tax lien and a tax deed state. How they're able to do that is Florida has tax liens that are offered with a 2-year redemption period and a maximum interest rate return of 18%. But they also have this fantastic thing that is an early redemption penalty. It means that it's a flat 5% that's added to any tax lien that redeems within the first year. Now, that early payoff penalty, what that does is it covers you on a tax lien if it, let's say, it redeemed too quickly and you were earning 1.5% per month, but it redeemed within the first month. So you're looking at a 1.5% return. Obviously, that really wouldn't be worth your time. So if they add that 5% flat on top of it, then in less than a month, you earn 6.5% on your money. And that's pretty good. That's really what that's all about. And what's interesting about that early redemption penalty is that for a long time, it attracted large financial institutions. They used to attend all of the Florida tax sales, and they used to buy liens up. And the reason they would do that is because they knew that a certain percentage of those liens were going to redeem within the first 3 to 6 months, and they're automatically earning 5% on top of whatever the interest rate was set at. In fact, in some cases, they would bid them down to where they were earning almost no interest, because I believe they'd also foreclose on a certain percentage of them as well.
And all of these states here are really, really good high interest rate states, and there's also some advantages to other states as well. It's just a different type of advantage. For example, me and Shade have went up and invested in Wyoming. Now, it doesn't offer a very high interest rate. You know, it's 10-12%, but the way that it's done, the opportunity, you know, 10% on a tax lien certificate, you know, I purchased a $1,600 tax lien certificate that was valued on a property worth almost $200,000. Purchased another $100 tax lien certificate on a building lot that was valued about $30,000 or $40,000. So these were good tax lien certificates that, you know, redeemed. And then, you know, Nebraska, some of the counties have pretty good county websites, or if you live within Colorado. And so, even though they may have a little bit lower interest rate, if you live within that area, it can still provide you with some pretty good opportunities at an interest rate that's going to be higher than most other type of investments. Shady, you there?
Here. Yeah, yes, I am. Yeah, I think that's totally true. In fact, a lot of times, really, what's just in your own backyard can offer a ton of opportunity. Now, yeah, some of these other states that are listed are, you know, these all offer high interest rate returns. Okay, so they're all going to offer a pretty good interest rate overall on tax lien investments. Now, another tip here, or number four, only purchase first year liens. Now, why only purchase first-year liens? What exactly are we talking about? If, let's say that a tax lien has a two-year redemption period. Well, really, that means that the, you know, they've got a grace period of 2 years. That also means that you're looking at more than just 1 year of delinquent taxes, and tax liens typically represent a single year of delinquent taxes. So what happens with properties is they'll get multiple liens, you know, placed against them. Now, when you get a first year lien, what that means is that you're buying the very first lien that that exists against the property, and there's a reason for that. The reason, you know, why you always want to buy the first year lien, and that's because every tax lien is sold, let's say, at the same time of the year, and they're sold with that 2 year redemption period. Well, the very first tax lien is going to be 1 year ahead of the other liens, and when it comes to the ability to foreclose on it, you know. So if you have to wait 2 years, that that first tax lien is going to have the first foreclosure rights. Also, when you buy the first lien, the county, let's say that you attend an auction. If you attend an auction, whatever the way is that they decide to use, I guess, whatever the competitive manner is, whether they use bid down the interest rate, or whether they use, sometimes they'll use an overbid process. But if they're bidding down the interest rate, one of the things that you'll find is when you purchase a first year lien, the county will oftentimes contact you to purchase the second year lien. You know, so let's say prior to the sale, a few weeks, they may contact you by telephone or by mail, and give you the opportunity to buy the next lien that would come against that property. Now, why exactly, you know, would you be interested in buying it? You know, why would the county think you're interested in buying it? Well, for number one, you get the maximum interest rate return if you buy it that way, because you are basically buying it, you know, before the sale, and it's without other competition. You automatically earn the state maximum. So that's one way to ensure that you make a good high interest rate return overall with the investment. But there's more reasons than just that. If you want to foreclose on a property, so let's say there's a two-year redemption period on a tax lien, and or let's say a three-year redemption period, just to make it a little more interesting. You buy a tax lien, and you wait out, you know, this long period of 3 years, and nothing happens with the property. Now, when it comes time to foreclose on the property, one of the requirements, so to actually foreclose and to transfer the properties, you know, to transfer the ownership to you, one of the requirements is that the property taxes are current. And if there's 3 years worth of delinquent taxes that are owed, every year they create a new lien, then if you purchase that first lien, they're going to contact you and offer you the opportunity to buy subsequent liens. you don't have to buy them. I mean, you can certainly, you know, if you're not in a position to buy them, or if for whatever reason you don't have to. If they sell it to somebody else, then you have another lien holder that exists. And really what that does is when you would go to foreclose on the property, you'd have to bring the taxes current, which would essentially mean probably paying the amount that it would have cost to buy, you know, that lien anyway. You know, and if there was a third lien, you know, then, you know, if you're dealing with a 3-year redemption period, then you have to kind of account for the taxes that are owed. So that's something to consider whenever you're thinking about, you know, a property is, you know, when you're looking at a property, you know, at a tax lien, and you're trying to determine, you know, whether or not this would be a good potential investment, think about how long the redemption period is. And how much is owed, you know, for, you know, the taxes, that tax lien, and, you know, and consider whether that property would be worth it, you know, with multiple, you know, it's in other words, if you've got a $4,000 tax lien and a 2-year redemption period, then you would think, okay, you know, for $8,000, would this property be worth it? You know, that's one way to look at it and consider it. Okay. Keep your lien to value ratio at 5% or less. I think everybody probably understands, you know, the lien to value ratio. I mean, essentially, what you're talking about is the face amount of the lien. You know, liens typically include all of the taxes, penalties, you know, fees that are owed on the property. So the county usually has that all included there in the amount for the lien. But like I said, liens are usually for a single year, not always the case. You know, there are some counties that will add, I think they combine amounts, but for most cases, counties will create separate liens for different years. So when we're talking about the lien to value ratio, what we're talking about is the lien amount compared to the estimated value of the property. So if we've got, let's say, a $100,000 home, to make these numbers really simple for us, what you're normally looking at for a lien amount, you know, a lien to value ratio, is about 0.5% to 3%. You know, would be the number. So you're talking about for a $100,000 property, that would mean that the tax lien amount, it could be as low in some cases as maybe $500, and you know, you see it sometimes. But more often it's going to be closer to 1% and then above, you know, so 1 to 3%, would mean, you know, $1,000 to $3,000 for, you know, on the tax lien for, you know, that, for that property. That's pretty average, pretty normal, you know, when you're looking at tax liens. The idea is to keep that number as low as possible, because, what it really represents is, your overall risk. Let's see if we can get the higher that bid to value ratio goes, or that lien to value ratio, the higher that goes, I guess the more you're paying for a property, and also, you know, the more the, I guess the lower profitability you have, you know, so, your profitability goes down and your, you know, your risk increases. You know, we set it at 5% because liens don't typically go really much above, even some of the lower numbers, you know, sometimes. But if you find a lien that has a number that's above 5%, then oftentimes it's an indication that there's something going on with it, that that maybe you're looking at more than 1 year's, you know, one year's worth of taxes and fees, or maybe they've got, you know, maybe there's some type of an issue. You know, what you don't want to do is, you know, I guess buy a lien that has a poor lien to value ratio, because it essentially means your money is just less secure. And if you wanted to foreclose on the property, you know, have to consider that, you know, you may have to pay that same amount multiple times.
You can kind of get a little bit of an idea just by looking through the list of what the property tax rate may be. So if most of the tax liens on a list are at 2% and you have one at 5%, then that's going to be, just like Shade said, a red flag. If they're all around 1% and you have, or, you know, and they have a really low property tax rate there, and maybe you see one at 4 or 5%, then you're going to want to look into it a little bit more, because it's different than the norm of the tax sale list you're looking at. That's going to give you a little bit of an indication of the property taxes that are being paid within within that area. So, you know, and it changes just depending on how much the property tax is. Some areas are really low, and some areas are even going, you know, are pretty high in property taxes.
Yeah. Yeah, I think absolutely. You know, we actually had a couple of questions here. I'm sorry, guys. I didn't see the questions that are coming in immediately. You know, there is, let's see here. Well, first, we've got a question. You know, how do you know it's a first year lien? I guess when you go to buy tax liens, there's a couple of different ways that you can determine it. Counties will sometimes let you know. You know, they'll let you know, whether something is a first year lien or not. But if you're looking at it from a list, then they'll oftentimes include tax years, and you'll be able to go back into the property and look and to see, with the tax years, if this is, you know, one of many liens. In fact, in some cases, there's even a tab or something you can click on that'll show other transactions or other, any other liens that might be associated with this particular property. Some counties make it easy. Others, may not have it be quite so obvious, but what you can usually tell is based on amounts. If you're keeping that lien to value ratio low, then you'll automatically avoid some of those properties. But as you start to look into the records, you don't have to. Well, in fact, that's one of the points here is that, you know, we want you to limit your due diligence. But we'll get into that here in just a second. The county will include certain records with tax liens, and part of those they're all property records, but the county's choosing to give you a portion of those tax records, and a portion of the county assessor's records, and so based on the information they have there, you can typically tell what you're looking at. Because I think they understand that's something that people are going to be looking for, is to figure out if there are other liens against the same property. And then another question here is, can you please explain a little bit more about Florida's 18% plus the 5% and how that works? Yes. First off, maximum interest rate returns, the way that those work is the state simply sets a maximum amount saying you can't make over this, but it also ends up being a type of default, in a way as well, because if there's no competition, you automatically earn the maximum interest rate. So that's set at 18%. It accrues 1.5% per month. The 5%, the 5% early payoff penalty, that applies to the first year. And essentially, what it means is if a lien redeems within the first year, then no matter really what your interest rate was, that you earned up to that point, you can automatically, add on 5% to that. And that's your return. That's basically what you will earn on it. So you're looking at, if you're earning 1.5% on it, let's say that you bought over the counter and so you're making a full 18% on it. So let's say 1.5% per month, and it's been 9 months. But 6 months. 6 months would be exactly half of that 18%. So we'd be looking at 9%. So you'd make 9% plus 5%. So you basically make 14% on your money. So if you had purchased a tax lien for $1,000, you would get back $140. Is that right? Or is that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. That's
pretty
right.
Sure. Well, and what it does help do, especially if you purchase a tax lien and they redeem the very next month, that's what that 5% really, at least, of course, it's going to help throughout the entire time. But if in a normal situation, if they redeem 1 or 2 months later, you may only make 3 or 4% on it. But with that 5% extra penalty, at least that gives you a pretty good return on top of what you're going to make per month if it redeems within the first 3 months.
Yes, yes.
It's kind of a safety net.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it was, I think, just designed, it was designed as kind of incentive, you know, it was an incentive there for people that were saying, well, you know, they basically wanted to make it work. And it is something that, that made the state, you know, quite popular. One of the questions here is, you know, is, hey, you know, they're wondering if sometime, you know, during the presentation, you know, you could speak to property foreclosure, acquisition, and eventual, you know, the sale process. How to locate, you know, a good locally based, you know, lawyer to assist in the process, et cetera. Absolutely. In fact, we'll go through this stuff pretty fast because I think we can. And we actually, that's kind of what we had planned here was to dive into and show because, well, we'll talk about it here in just a second. But the reality of it is if you are trying to find out ways or looking for ways to build up the capital that you have, you know, your working capital, then chances are tax liens are not going to be the best vehicle for you. Tax liens really work best. You have to consider them long-term investments. So, if you're looking at, comparing tax liens to other types of retirement funds or retirement investing or something that's a fairly long-term investment, tax liens will beat hands down anything. There's nothing that can touch tax liens that provides any level of security like tax liens do. Tax liens aren't a gamble because it's very simple to pick good tax liens. And that's actually part of what this whole point was about was with tax liens, they're different than with tax deeds. When you buy a tax lien, they don't convey ownership rights. And therefore, you're also not getting ownership concerns. All you're buying is lien against the property. So, what you're really concerned with is to make sure that the property that the lien's been placed against, it has significant value. Whether it's worth $120,000 or $100,000 doesn't really matter to you because it doesn't significantly change, the security of your investment. Chances are it's going to redeem. But just in the offhand that it didn't and you needed to foreclose, you want it to be a great property. So you don't have to do tons and tons of research. What you really need to do are just a couple of things, kind of goes into this one point right here, which is, you know, you're better off buying one lien that's a little bit more money than to buy a bunch of smaller liens. And it all ties into the same thing, really. And that is that to really invest safely in tax liens, what you want to avoid is useless land. Useless land is the biggest risk you face, whether that's tax liens or tax deeds. You know, so whether you're dealing sometimes I read questions and suddenly I completely lose track of whatever I know because my mind just goes off on a completely different track. Okay. With useless land, with it being the biggest risk, like I said, that is true of tax liens or tax deeds. There are simple ways to avoid it. And there are more steps involved and more things you need to do with due diligence when you're actually buying the property, like in a standard, you know, in a tax deed, you're buying a property outright versus the tax lien where you're not. But we still want to make sure that we can avoid useless land. So how exactly do we do that? Well, there are a couple of things that we can do. First off, if we want to avoid useless land, then there's a really easy rule you can set. There's a really easy thing you can do with tax liens, and that is avoid everything pretty much except for land plus improvements. You know, what that means is whenever you have a piece of land plus improvements, it usually means there's a structure, building, home, commercial property, something on the property. And if you know from there, if you can get any kind of a view of what it is, you know, then you typically know. That's what you're looking for. Why? Because that's going to guarantee value and use. A home has use. Commercial property has use. If there's structure on there, then chances are it has use. Again, this should be the value of this should be way over what the tax lien is. So the lien to value ratio should be below that 5%, and it should be a first year lien. So if those dots right there all connect, if the percentages are right, it's a property with improvements, all of those things right there, you're going to have a lien that will be a good lien. In fact, if you just focused on single family homes and said, I only buy tax liens against single family homes, you would never go wrong. I mean, you know, if you ever got a chance to foreclose on a property, it would be a home run. You know, you'd knock it out of the park because, you know, you'd be foreclosing on a house for so very little money. Let's see here. Oh, good question. Here's a good question here that we'll cover here. Okay, what if you find out there are other liens in the property after you have invested in the tax lien? Are you responsible for other liens? No. And in fact, you know, if a county made something, you know, sometimes they would make this stuff, you know, like on a list. But if they don't and you found out, you know, that you purchased a tax lien against a property that had other liens against it, don't worry. You know, it doesn't necessarily mean anything. I guess when you're looking at the different types of liens that there might be out there, tax liens are what are known as a first position lien. That's because they're a judicial lien, meaning that they're a lien that goes through the state laws and they go through the courts. And so they essentially extinguish anything, you know, any ownership rights that that somebody would have to the property. You know, I guess, sorry, that's what that's when the foreclosure takes place. But with the tax lien, because you're not actually buying that, you really don't have to worry about that, about something like that. Like, for instance, other liens against the property. Now, are you talking other tax liens or other, like an IRS lien or something like that? You know, because, you know, if you find out there are other tax liens against the property, then, you know, you could have the opportunity to buy them. And sometimes you'll find properties that have more than one tax lien against them. And, you know, that can either be a great opportunity to maybe buy something and begin foreclosing on it immediately, or, you know, earn a good interest rate return. Or if there are too many liens against the property, then it could be an indication that there's something wrong.
Yeah, and a kind of a good indication that is whatever the redemption period is. You know, if it's a four-year redemption period and there's 4 years worth of back taxes, and if you paid off all four, you would have, you know, essentially you could start the foreclosure process, then that would be a good one. But if it had 8 years worth of back taxes, then that's something you're going to avoid, because to pay off all those property taxes is going to be more than the redemption period.
Yeah. So now,
the 2 year redemption period, you know, look for you know, if it has 2 years worth, then you're going to be usually pretty safe. Don't invest into three or four.
Yeah. Now Cindy's saying, you know, what if it was like an IRS lien? And when I was mentioning that they're a first position lien, first position liens take priority or precedence over, you know, other types of liens or claims. The only exception to that is if there's some other type of a first position lien, like an IRS lien is also a first position lien. It doesn't mean that one has, you know, power over another. It's really a matter of which one was placed first. You know, an IRS lien is placed against the property. You don't really have to worry about that. I mean, if you can avoid, I guess it depends on what you want to do. You know, if you're looking for the safest way to invest beforehand, then you can avoid it. But if you bought one that has an IRS lien against it, I wouldn't get too worried. You know, the worst case scenario when it comes to tax liens is if something weird goes on, like, for instance, let's say that there's like a bankruptcy that has property taxes included with it, which doesn't happen very often. But if it happened, property taxes were included, the worst case scenario is you get back your initial investment. You may even get back your initial investment plus, you know, interest up to the point where, you know, where bankruptcy was filed. That's the absolute worst thing, you know, that could happen. And even in that, you still get your money back. You know, so the worst case scenario, if there was something, I mean, so let's say the IRS decided they were going to take it, you know, you'd get your money back. You know, that's essentially what would happen is you would get your money back, you know, but it may not have interest, you know, that's included with it. Okay, now let's see. Let's just skip through this. Over the counter, I think everybody understands. Over the counter liens make maximum interest rate returns. And let's talk for a minute about some of these lists. Let's look at, let's take